All right, well, let's get started. It's a little after seven, and welcome everybody from all around the globe. We're glad
to have you. No pun intended.
That's a good one, Michael. Yeah. So welcome everybody. Again, my name is Jeffrey Sheehan. I'm the co-founder and artistic associate at Capital Classics Theater Company, primarily known for our Greater Hartford Shakespeare Festival in the summertime on the lovely campus at the University of St. Joseph here in West Hartford. I want to assure you that we are planning and moving full steam ahead to have a festival this summer. What it's going to look like and what all the rules and regulations are going to be come that time, we don't know, but we are going to be performing As You Like It in some way outdoors on the lawn.
So, yay!
Yes, and the vaccines have given us great hope, and the new vaccination calendar here in Connecticut seems to really work in our favor. Also, for those of you, you'll find out soon enough, I know those of you on our mailing list, we did push the dates of the festival back 2 weeks so that we could go as late in the summer as possible. So we'll be starting the festival on Thursday, July 29th, and running through August 15th this year. So just to give us more time, to give the world more time to get healthy, we thought that was good. But we're working on the details. We're keeping some things at bay until we absolutely have to make a decision, but you can be sure we will definitely be doing an outdoor performance of As You Like It this summer. So keep that in mind, mark your calendars, and I'm sure we'll remind you every book club leading up to it. We'll certainly let you guys know. So we're very excited to at least have that to look forward to getting back in the outdoor stage. So, all right. So again, the theme for this season's Shakespeare Book Club is a passion for power. And so we're taking a look at The Tempest tonight. And again, we're not looking at the play itself and all its themes. We're focusing on those parallel storylines that happen in The Tempest in which people are pursuing power. So I know there's a lot of power dynamics in the play that we'll hold off until the end if we have some time. Like, you know, of course, there's the power dynamic of Prospero and Caliban. There's the power dynamic of Prospero and Ariel going on in this play. But we're not going to look at those because it's about that passion for power. And in those two storylines and relationships in this play, Prospero already has the power. And Caliban and Ariel aren't really looking to replace Prospero with themselves. They are not looking to gain power. They're looking to gain freedom from the imprisoning power that Prospero has over them. So that's a different dynamic. But again, we can hold those on the back burner. And if we have time after we take a look at the parallel plot lines of Sebastian, Antonio, and Alonso, and then the comedic side of things with Caliban, Trinculo, and Stephano, and we can compare and take a look at what happens in those storylines, take a look at Shakespeare's attitude towards one more serious one and then one definitely comedic approach on the usurpation, the employment of violence in that usurpation of somebody in a seat of power so that somebody else could take over that seat. So that's the goal for tonight. And we can get things started by looking at where things get started in the play itself. And as we come up with excerpts, I'll share, I've got the Folger edition ready for me to share on our screen so we could all look at the text together. So as we begin, I have to get the Lord Mayor to approve, absolutely. But hopefully that will all happen well. So I think it's good to introduce this idea of passion for power with the first instance the idea is introduced in the play. And it comes in the scene, act one, scene two, when Prospero is telling Miranda, this is how we got here. This is why we're here. What do you remember about it? So let's cut it back. And this introduces us to the characters we're about to meet. It also introduces, we'll get to this point later on in this scene with an excerpt, as to why Prospero is acting so urgently now and what is behind him. So we've got Prospero and Miranda sitting down with Prospero telling Miranda, I have a very, very important thing to tell you. Something that apparently he never has in her 16 years of life. He never told her. But here on this page here, you can see he starts to tell her the deviousness behind their situation and what happened. And he starts to tell her about his brother and her uncle. Obviously, she wouldn't remember him. She was so young when they got exiled, tossed on their rickety little boat and sent off to the sea. But the way he describes the situation, right? My brother and my uncle, that a brother should be so perfidious. He whom next thyself of all the world I loved, and to him put the manage of my state. As at that time, through all the signories, it was the first, and Prospero the prime duke, being so reputed in dignity and for the liberal arts without a parallel. And those being all my study, the government, I cast upon my brother. And to my state grew stranger, being transported and wrapped in secret studies. So he's taking some responsibility here for giving up his responsibility in the seat of power that he owned. Yes, he just had greater interest, didn't want the responsibility, but he didn't give up his seat. And I think that's an important thing to look at. He just said, you do all the work. I'm going to stay the Duke, and I'm going to go off into my books and study and learn magic and play. But here we have that turn, called him perfidious already, and then calls him false. And then asks Miranda, are you sure you're listening to me?
No.
And then we can jump ahead. Being once perfected, how to grant suits and how to deny them, who to advance and who to trash for overtopping. So apparently those are some of the key criteria to being a duke, being a leader, is knowing how to give out favors and deny favors, who to help move forward and who to get rid of for having too much ambition. New created the creatures that were mine, I say, or changed them, or else new formed them, having both the key of officer and office, set all hearts of the state to what tune pleased his ear. And now he was the ivy which had hid my princely trunk and sucked my verdure out on it. So we see this change. We see something happening to his brother, Sebastian. We see things shifting in there. Once he got into that seat of power, something started to happen to him. And then he talks about that he is neglecting all his worldly ends. In my false brother awaked an evil nature, and my trust, like a good parent, to beget of him a falsehood, in its contrary as great as my trust was, which had indeed no limit. And then we move a little. He being thus lorded, not only with what my revenue yielded, but what my power might else exact. Like one who, having into truth by telling of it, made such a sinner of his memory to credit his own lie, he didn't believe he was indeed the Duke, out of the substitution and executing the outward face of royalty with all prerogative. And we see his ambition begins to grow. I'm just going to get through this little part, and then we'll open it up for discussion on these descriptions of what power is. Oh, did I say? Oh, thank you, Mila. My bad. I do know that. And that to have no screen between this part he played and him he played before, he needs will be absolute, Milan. He needed that absolute. power. Me, my poor man, my library was dukedom large enough. And of temporal royalties, he thinks me now incapable. Confederate, so dry he was for sway with the king of Naples, to give him annual tribute, do him homage, subject his coronet to his crown, and bend the dukedom yet unbowed, alas, poor Milan, to most ignoble stooping. So we see Antonio getting in an alliance with Alonso to set and increase his power, increase his position, and securing his position in that seat. And the king of Naples, being an enemy to me inveterate, hearkens my brother's suit, which was that he, in lieu of the premises of homage, and I know not how much tribute, should presently extirpate me and mine out of the dukedom and confer fair Milan with all of the honors on my brother. Whereon a treacherous army levied one midnight, fated to the purpose, did Antonio open the gates of Milan, and in the dead of darkness, the ministers for the purpose hurried thence me and thy crying self. So that's Prospero's perspective and description of what happened back there in Milan and what happened to his brother as he decided to get rid of his own sense of responsibilities and put those responsibilities on his brother without ever really conferring on him the power. But we saw something happening to Antonio as he started to gain this taste of power, this taste of wealth, and all that happened in it. So let's open that passage up to you guys in terms of that description of power, bastardized power, I should say. And does that cause you to think anything? Do you recognize anything in there? Does it make sense to you? Do you disagree with it? Is there something that you would like to counter with that? So go ahead and use your raise hand little icon down there, or you can raise it in your screen, and we'll try to catch you. Barbara.
Well, you asked does it sound kind of like realistic or whatever? And I do think that, you know, they say that power corrupts. And so when his brother took over at first, he seemed to just do what he was supposed to do. But then when you get the power, you almost want more power and more power, and not even realizing necessarily how it consumes you, to the point where he throws his brother out and hopes he dies.
right. Sets him up to do so. Yeah. Yeah. Lisa Barron.
Yes. So I'm going back and reading a lot of the Stoics right now, Aurelius's Meditations and Epictetus, his works. And so in the lines 105 to 110, we have Prospero saying, me, poor man, my library was dukedom large enough. So it, for me, it brings up, who do we have a duty to? What's our duty to human nature, to society as a whole, versus our own internal desires or needs? Because he was the duke of his library. That was his kingdom. That's what gave his life meaning and insight. Yet, is Shakespeare bringing up what, you know, how much insularity from the world and how much do we owe other human beings? So I've always found that section brings up that question for me.
Yeah, terrific. Does anybody want to comment? How much responsibility do we have, especially if we are in a seat of power, especially a power that's structured not like a democratic power, but one in which you are born into or fought for or placed in that seat?
Yes.
You know, with great power comes great responsibility too. That's another saying about power. Go ahead, Michael Clements.
Yeah. So obviously this was a theme that Shakespeare was very interested in, because his last, you know, true comedy, you know, his problem play Measure for Measure also deals with the same issue when Vincenzo, you know, didn't really take initially his job responsibly. So he goes in sort of incognito. So I know we can't do this, but I also know I like to do it. I imagine what was in Shakespeare's head. So right.
Yeah, no, as long as we know we're imagining. I like doing it too. It's one of my favorite things to do. Yeah. Yeah, so obviously it is a theme that he goes to again and again and again. This idea of power is a constant presence in so many of his plays, especially even in the history plays. That's those parts of history that he focuses on. Is who has it, who wants it, what are they doing to get it, and what are they doing to keep it? And it's usually pretty brutal.
Jeff?
Yes, is that you, Mila?
Yes, that's me.
How come I can't see you anymore? I saw you before.
Yeah, I'll start the video again.
Okay. I think we have two pages of people, Jeff.
Yeah, but I had turned my video off. Maybe. Okay. Okay, now
there you are.
Yeah, okay. I have a couple of quick things to say. One about this idea of getting into Shakespeare's head. It certainly is clear that one of James's problems was his devotion to his books. That you know, he was a great book lover and he had a great deal of trouble ruling his kingdom. So I think there's a likelihood that both of these dukes who give away their power, and especially Prospero, because after all, Prospero is kind of a revisited Lear, right? That Lear also gives away his power, but he does it for a much more selfish kind of reason, so that he can crawl unburdened towards death. Whereas Prospero wants to, he just loves his books and he loves his study, and I think that there is a quality, a mirror for magistrates quality to this play, where Shakespeare is really holding the mirror up to James a little bit, saying, your study is not kingdom enough if you want to keep your kingdom, especially considering that there was so much insurrection abroad against James in the first place. And then beyond that, this does bring up the question of the relationship between the active and the contemplative life, which was a really huge issue for the 15th and 16th centuries. And in the 15th century, some public people, primarily women, solved it by creating a kind of active contemplative life. That is, Henry VII's mother, Margaret Beaufort, was an ascetic. She said 60 prayers before lunch, before dinner every day. She wore a hair shirt. And she was arrested for treason for trying to get her the throne for her son when she was married to the brother of the king. And so the idea that there could be a correlation between the active and the contemplative life, that you could be a contemplative with ambition and a desire for power, was a concept that 100 years earlier, when Elizabeth's grandfather took the throne, was very well understood in the kingdom, especially among women. I don't know of any active contemplative men, but there were women who did that. And James seems to me to be kind of falling into that mold. That's it.
That's great. When you talked about rebellion and uprisings against him abroad, where were those things happening? Was it in the north, in Ireland, in France? What were those dynamics he was dealing with?
Not so much abroad as in the Kingdom of England. No, it was the Parliament itself. You know, they cut off his money. I mean, this is the Puritan-controlled group that will behead his son. And they were already uneasy about James, first of all, because James didn't, you know, his mother was beheaded by Queen Elizabeth. Yep. He assisted in that. I mean, he was a party to that beheading. He betrayed his mother. But nevertheless, he wasn't in a direct line of inheritance for the throne. So he had to do a lot to secure his position. And just very shortly after the Tempest was written, of course, his daughter would marry Frederick, the Elector Palatine of Hanover,
No.
And you would bring the Germans into the English royal family, where they have had a camp ever since. So that James was doing what he could to solidify his power abroad, I would say. There were Irish problems too. I maybe somebody else knows the particular dates of those. They're always around, and they were bedeviling James as well. But I think the real issue was just his attempt to triumph over Parliament. The king didn't have much private income. The Parliament had to vote his money. And so he dissolved the Parliament two or three times in the period between 1605 and 1610. He just told them to go home. But once they went home, his income was diminished enormously. So you talk about the desire for power. Desire was kind of built into a need to have a finance. And he was in a standoff with Parliament for that reason. This is a little bit far afield. Let's come back to the play.
It's impossible. Well, thank you for that, because, you know, it does connect with a lot of the descriptions that Shakespeare is giving Prospero to use in describing what his brother Antonio does, you know, in terms of who you're going to grant favors to and not, who you're going to advance and who you're going to get rid of. And that you need money. You need to pay people in order to secure your own power. You need to get that money from somewhere in order to do it. So I think a lot of that stuff that you talked about happening in that time, it has its echoes in this text. Well, go ahead, Dennis.
Especially because James was actually selling titles.
No, even better. Yep, even better. Go ahead, Dennis.
Yeah, I like that. I like that dichotomy of just mentioned learning. You can have learning and the joy of knowledge and a hunger for knowledge, or you can have a hunger for power and you can pursue power. And it's hard to have both. And I thought that was a really good way of looking at it. But what is really nice, I really like this play. The book learning that Prospero pursued, although it resulted in him losing power immediately, he later gained power through his learnings, the power of the occult and magic. And in the end, he was able to exert his will on his enemies. So I really like that. So it showed that knowledge is in fact power.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, good. A nice cycle through
that. He used it to his advantage. It's not a natural advantage, but then he did use it to his advantage. And then the other point I had was, I don't know who said power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So Antonio sees the dukedom from his brother, and power is what motivates him. And he was not satisfied after the shipwreck. He was conspiring with Alonso's brother, Sebastian, to actually kill Alonso.
We'll get to that. Hold that thought, Dennis. We'll get to that section.
Okay. I'll wait then.
Herb has a shout out to Dennis's Tempest themed Zoom background. Well done, Dennis.
I have to admit, I didn't paint that.
Not yet. Lisa Marin, go ahead.
Yes, just really quickly to speak to Dennis's point. How does Prospero arguably become a more ethical leader throughout the course of the play? He frees Ariel. He forgives Caliban. Caliban arguably takes the island back over, has a shot at it. Is that through his learning or is that through something else?
Yeah, that's a great question. I'll let you guys examine it, because I played Prospero once, and that was, there were moments in there of his turning through this arc that took some study to really grasp and understand, because some of them happened pretty quickly.
Yes.
Go ahead, Michael Clemens.
That's a great point in my mind. Yeah, I can't remember. Did Prospero actually... Did we actually see Ariel being free? Because numerous times said, I'll free you. He said at least 6, 7, 8 times, but did he actually free him?
He does.
He does, okay.
Yeah. At the very end, And we do know he's leaving that island too. Right. So those spirits who possess the island, who are part of that island, there's no indication that they're leaving it. You know, like Lisa said, Caliban does have that chance to, again, live freely on the island. Whether he takes it over or runs it, we wonder, you know, because he never really seemed to want that. He wanted to be free from the pain and imprisonment that Prospero had given him. Deborah Vatcher, I think I saw your hand up, right? He's got to unmute you.
Yeah. Here you go. Here we go. Great. Can you hear me? Yes. Yeah, I thought personally the arc for Prospero changed when Ariel says, "If I were human." And then something clicks with Prospero and, oh, wait.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, that was the moment I landed on too. Yeah, as a major awakening for him. Yeah, cool. Amila.
Yes, let me just pick up on that quickly because I was going to make the same point Deborah did. It's Ariel who teaches him sympathy.
Yep.
You know, he says, "I feel sorry for these guys. I'm not human. You should."
Yeah.
And Prospero does do that. He then converts to that. But it's kind of interesting that it takes Ariel to push him there. And once he gets there, Antonio and Sebastian just move out of the picture. That is, he forgives them.
Mm-hmm.
They don't accept the forgiveness, nor are they penitent, nor are they contrite. Like Jessica at the end of The Merchant of Venice, they just shut up. They just totally disappear. And Jeff, you could, as a director, could do whatever the hell you like with them. They could be over sharpening their knives in the corner. They are have nothing to say. So he forgives brothers who do not seek forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
And then he reconciles. But he makes, I think, a very, very specific generic choice. Shakespeare makes it for him, of course, but he lets Prospero say it. When he says the rarer something is in virtue than in vengeance.
Right.
I don't have the exact quotation in front of me. But of course, virtue is kind of forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
And forgiveness is the key to the comic world, to the comedic world. Forgiveness and reconciliation. Vengeance is the driving force of the tragic world. And so in Act 5, Prospero really has a choice between whether he wants this to turn tragic or whether he wants it to turn comic. And that choice is made when he prefers what he calls virtue over vengeance. It's a very, very specific kind of choice.
Yes.
Then one last little tiny thing I'll throw in here. I don't want you to talk about it, but you do know that in the whole world of the Caribbean, this play is turned upside down, that it's seen in the opposite side, that Prospero is seen as the villain and the enemy, and Caliban is seen as the colonized hero. And there's a ton of stuff out there about that. A play by a Césaire called A Tempest, which is all about that. And George Lamming, a very famous novelist. There's a guy at Temple University who wrote a book called Caliban and the Yankees about colonization. So not everybody sees Prospero as the hero.
This always struck me. How brilliant Shakespeare's vision was in understanding the eventual effects of colonization. Because it didn't quite take, by the time he wrote this, it had been happening for a while in this new world, but it was just really starting to become an economic stronghold. And his ability to see where this was heading, reveal it in this play, I always found really brilliant. Did you have your hand up at one point? Barbara, did you have your hand up?
Yeah, I did. I mean, it was going with the comment that was made before. I mean, my question is, I mean, Prospero can be rather magnanimous because he got what he wanted. You know, he wanted to like secure the fate of his daughter in the sense that he wanted to make sure that she was married off. He's, you know, successfully, you know, took care of his brother in a way. And so it's interesting that he like releases Ariel and he lets Caliban do whatever he wants, but Prospero's not going to be there anymore anyway. So he's used his power of magic and illusion to get what he wants. And now he doesn't need it anymore because he even says he's going to throw away his books.
Yeah. And his staff and
right.
And drown it all. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. So in a sense, when he returns, he's not going to have the power anymore because he's saying how he's giving that all of that up.
He's not going to have that power.
Yeah.
He may be a more effective leader, as Lisa had questioned before. Let's go Dennis and then Lisa Barron. Go ahead, Dennis.
Yeah, he gets what he wants, but actually, to me, that was really one of the reasons I like the play, because initially he was ousted from his position and exiled, which is a bad, terrible thing to go through. So it makes me happy that he, in the end, he got what he wanted. And I wanted to mention that theme of power is almost in every character. If you look at even Sebastian or Trinculo.
Trinculo, and we're gonna get there too, Dennis. We'll get there too.
Anyway, they were drunk, but they were also dreaming about power with Caliban.
Yeah,
they
we'll would get take there. Over.
Okay,
it's in the plans. Sorry. Go ahead, Lisa, and then Miller.
Yes, quickly to Barbara's point, did he get everything he wants in giving up this magic? And if we look at that as a metaphor or an analogy to Shakespeare giving up theater, what he's given up something too. Isn't there a certain vibrancy in his life because of the magic and the imagination that he throws into the sea? And then of course we have the famous words at the end.
Mm-hmm. Sure, thoughts on that. A couple of things to point out too, in the change that we were asking about the arc of his journey, and what Deborah had pointed out and Mila and that I confirmed when playing them, I landed on that idea where he changed from vengeance to virtue, the rarer action is virtue. Than in vengeance. So that tells us for a while there what he wanted was vengeance. Yes, he wanted to make his life safe for his daughter, because honestly, if you think about it, you know, he says at the end, every third thought is going to be his grave once he returns to Milan. He had to have been thinking that here she is heading into womanhood, and what kind of life is he going to leave her, especially if he dies on that island and leaves her there. Right, what is he leaving her to? So there's something about that, but then a big part of his desire seems to be vengeance, because he revels in the pain he causes them, in the confusion he causes them, in the sorrow and sadness he has caused Alonso. He's reveling in that until, as was pointed out, Ariel reminds him of his humanity. And then he goes in that direction. So there's a shift that happens in what he seems to be wanting over the course of this play, which makes it something really beautiful. Go ahead, Mila.
Yes, I mean, many people read this play as Prospero as a stand-in for Shakespeare. And I think it's a very easy thing to do, because he does bury his book and all that kind of stuff. But not only that, you know, the play begins, this is a play without a source. And so the audience actually did not know the plot, as they often knew the plot of most of Shakespeare's plays. So when that storm happens, there is, Jeff, I'll mention one other power battle that I think you're not going to mention, so it won't be one we're getting to. That. And that's the one in the scene that precedes this, between the bosun and his passengers, right? Use your authority.
Yeah.
If you can, what care these roarers for the name of king?
That's right.
You know, get the hell out of here and let me do my job if you want to stay alive, right?
Yeah.
So the power at that point becomes keeping the boat afloat, right? Right. And the only person who can do it is the person who knows how the boat works.
That's right. And everybody else has become equalized in the eyes of this storm.
The medic, yeah. I mean, he is the sole authority on that boat. So you have that theme coming up just boom right out of the gate. But not only that, the audience assumes this is a real storm.
Right.
What the first scene sets up is the apparent overarching power of nature over humanity, right? Mm-hmm. And what are Miranda's first words in Act One, Scene Two? If by your art, you have raised this storm. Yeah. So immediately we learn that who can fill an empty space, who can inhabit, you know, airy nothingness? Of course, the playwright. Who can put a storm on the stage? The playwright. Yeah. Who can fill in the space? The playwright. And so art immediately becomes the real key to sort of artistic power, the real key to the power in the theater. As soon as Prospero begins to say that, yes, he created this storm. So even above the so-called natural elements, there is the playwright, the artist,
very cool,
whose power is straight through this play.
Jeff, awesome. I think Bob had a question.
All right, do you, Bob?
I was going to make two points, and Miller just made it much more eloquently than I could. But it is an interesting comment on power. We start in chapter two, in Act Two, people after power, but here in Act One, we see that power is very fleeting. The boatswain, the king is not a king. We're all equals. So there's always this already introduced this ambiguity about power and about personal power. So that was one point I was going to make. The second point about the Ark of Prospero, I think it was Barbara that introduced this notion of release. Many times during the play, power is exercised by release. We see it in the beginning when Ariel is released from the tree. We see it toward the end where all the bad things are happening to the various actors, they're being released. So it's an interesting idea about power, that power can be expressed by releasing people and individuals from the exercise of power. So I thought this was kind of an interesting idea about power, giving up control as a exercise of power.
Yeah, very cool. All right, so I would like to point out Edwin's backdrop is a picture from Capitol Classics production of The Tempest. Back in 2009. Way to go, Edwin. That was us out on the lawn. And I'll tell you, I don't know if we conjured it or not, but man, that was a rainy, tempestuous summer, wasn't it?
I think nature provided the special effects for this production.
We did. A lot of wet weather that year. All right, so any last comments on that chunk? And we will move on to start looking at those parallel paths of the pursuit of power that Dennis so desperately wants to talk about, is prepared to do so. Any last things on that opening introduction to power?
Just one last thing, Jeff, and that is that Prospero doesn't go back to Europe to be a ruler. He gives the rule over to his daughter and his son-in-law. Ferdinand and Miranda are going to rule, apparently, both Naples and his Duke of Milan, right? Yeah. They're going to be very powerful rulers, but he's going back to dream of death. So he's not actually going back to reassume power. Yeah. Just a quick point.
Yep, sure. Just a quick thing about that line that I had an interesting thought about is that where he says every third thought shall be my grave, where a lot of what was driving my understanding of Prospero and playing him was that the thought of his grave was his first thought for a very long time heading into this day. And that he had been contemplating what's going to happen to my daughter when I die. And that his grave was a predominant thought in his head. And now that these things are in place, he could actually reduce it to his third thought and have room in his thinking for a couple of other thoughts before he really had to worry about dying now. So I played that line with that perspective. I could breathe a little. My daughter is safe. and the idea of dying is not forefront anymore because the consequences of it aren't as dreaded. So there was just something about the way he worded it that made me look at that line very specifically, contemplate what it could mean there. So, all right, so let's take a look at our next step into the pursuit of power. I'm gonna get us up to some of that text. And it is the conversation between Antonio and Sebastian when Ariel sends everybody to sleep, except for the two of them. Let me get to that spot.
It's act two, scene one.
Thank you. That act one, scene two. That act two is a monster of a scene. That thing goes on forever.
It's around 2:10 or so, at 2:20.
Right. And here we are. Great, thank you. So there goes Alonzo. He falls asleep. And here we start to have the conversation of this opportunity that is presenting itself. And who recognizes this opportunity first? Well, of course, Antonio does, because he's already been through this. He has spotted his own opportunity, and now he sees another one for his friend. Right here at 2:26, so we'll start, come on. If you can all see that, I'm trying to highlight it, but right
Jeff,
there.
Can you share your screen?
Why it's not working. Okay, there we go. Thank you. Did I not do that last time either?
No.
Sorry. Okay. I forgot to hit that button.
Yeah. All right, Jeff, we just improvise.
Yeah, I know. Jeez, after a year, you'd think I could Zoom. All right, so this is where we're going to begin, with Antonio. And this is where Shakespeare gets me every time. He just really knows how to give somebody the right words to say that so capture who they are as a character, as a person, as they're thinking. He doesn't just come out and say it. Much more devious about that and delicious about the idea. Just look at this. What might, worthy Sebastian? Oh, what might? No more. And yet methinks I see it in thy face, what thou shouldst be. The occasion speaks thee, and my strong imagination sees a crown dropping upon thy head. And Sebastian says, what, art thou waking? Do you not hear me speak? I do, and surely it is a sleepy language, and thou speakst out of thy sleep. What is it thou didst say? This is a strange repose, to be asleep with eyes wide open, standing, speaking, moving, and yet so fast asleep. Noble Sebastian, thou lets thy fortune sleep, die rather, winks, whilst thou art waking. Now thou dost snore distinctly. There's meaning in thy snores. I am more serious than my custom, which we know is true, because the whole first part of Act 2, Scene 1 is them mocking Gonzalo, making fun, having what they perceive as humorous insult asides and quips between the two of them. I am more serious than my custom. You must be so too, if heed me, which to do trebles the o'er. So now, before he even says what his plan is, he's dropping the reward. Before he even says it, if you listen to me, you will be three times what you are right now. And that's where then Sebastian says, well, I'm standing water. I'll teach you how to flow. And again, you can see by Shakespeare's, as we all know, how he uses the poetic lines. We see Antonio finish, Sebastian finish that blank verse line, and then Antonio is right in there. I'll teach you how to flow, and Sebastian's right on it. Do so to ebb, hereditary sloth instructs me. So they're starting to finish each other's sentences now, starting to finish each other's thoughts. They are thinking in alignment now, and Shakespeare gives us, the reader or the actors, right there on the page how to do it. And then Antonio finished. Hereditary sloth instructs me. Oh, he comes in again. A Shakespearean expression of an idea and a thought. To ebb, hereditary sloth instructs me. Oh, if you but knew how you the purpose cherish, whilst thus you mock it, how in stripping it you more invest it. Ebbing men indeed most often do so near the bottom, run by their own fear or sloth. Prithee say on, finishing the line again. No, tell me. He's got Sebastian right on the hook now. Tell me. The setting of thine eye and cheek proclaim a matter from thee and a birth indeed, which throws thee much to yield. Thus, sir, now I'm going to tell you, although this lord of weak remembrance, this who shall be of his little memory when he is earth, hath here almost persuaded. For he's a spirit of persuasion, only professes to persuade the king his son's alive. 'Tis as impossible that he's undrowned as he that sleeps here swims. I have no hope that he's undrowned. Oh, out of that no hope, what great hope you have. Again, you see them finishing each other's lines. The ideas are starting to come together. No hope that way is another way. So high a hope that even ambition cannot pierce a wink beyond. But doubt discovery there. Will you grant with me the Fernandez drowned? He's gone. Then tell me, who's the next heir of Naples? Claribel. And then Antonio takes it over. You see all the complete iambic pentameter lines there. She that is queen of Tunis, she that dwells 10 leagues beyond man's life, she that from Naples can have no note unless the sun were post, and the man in the moon is too slow, till newborn chins be rough and razorable, she that from whom we all were sea swallowed, though some cast again, and by that destiny to perform an act whereof what's past is prologue, what to come in yours and my discharge. And then there's a break, a breath. What stuff is this? How say you? 'Tis true, my brother's daughter's queen of Tunis. So is she heir of Naples. Twixt which regions there is some space, a space whose every cubit seems to cry out, how shall that Claribel measure us back to Naples? Keep in Tunis and let Sebastian wake. Say this were death. Then now hath seized them. Why, they were no worse than now they are. There be that can rule Naples as well as he that sleeps. Lords that can prate as amply and unnecessarily as this Gonzalo. I myself could make a chuff of as deep chat. Oh, that you bore the mind that I do. What a sleep were this for your advancement. Do you understand me? It is brilliant, brilliant manipulation. Now you see on the page, Antonio finishing his ideas. Methinks I do. And how does your content tender your own good fortune? I remember you did supplant your brother Prospero. True. And look how well my garments sit upon me, much feeder than before. My brother's servants were then my fellows. Now they are my men. But for your conscience? And then that line's not finished. Aye, sir, where lies that? If 'twere a kibe to put me to my slipper, but I feel not this deity in my bosom. 20 consciousness that stand twixt me and Milan, candy be they and melt ere they molest. Here lies your brother, no better than the earth he lies upon. If he were that which now he's like, that's dead, whom I with disobedient steel, 3 inches of it, can lay to bed forever, whilst you, doing thus to the perpetual wing, for I might put this ancient morsel, this Sir Prudence, who should not abrade our course. For all the rest, they'll take suggestion as a cat laps milk. They'll tell the clock to any business that we say befits the hour. Thy case, dear friend, shall be my precedent. As thou got'st Milan, I'll come by Naples. Draw thy sword. One stroke shall free thee from the tribute which thou payest, and I, the king, shall love thee. Draw together, and when I rear my hand, do you the like to fall it on Gonzalo? Oh, but one word, and off they go, which gives Ariel the chance to step in. At the end there, we find out what Antonio stands to benefit from this action. He no longer has to pay money to Naples to stay as Milan. That tribute will go back into his pocket. So here we certainly see a passion for power. Antonio gets it started. He woos and seduces Sebastian along the way until Sebastian is with him. And there they are by the end of that section, ready to act upon it. And again, Shakespeare, man, that guy's pretty good. So I'm going to stop sharing so I can see you all. But if you want to see anything, I can go back to it if you don't have a copy of that yourself. So as we start to see the darker plot line that's in this pursuit of power versus the comedic one that we'll see in a bit with Stephano Trinculo and Caliban, what does that make you guys think? What's your response to that exploration of this dark-edged, dangerous, deadly passion and pursuit of power? Michael Clements.
Just a brief comment. I think Dennis had mentioned that Antonio reminds him of Lady Macbeth, but I also see the Iago-esque, you know, that, you know, just, you know, sort of playing on people's more base nature. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I think even some of the imagery used is very parallel to Lady Macbeth. I see this happening in my imagination. I can picture the crown on you, and in my imagining it, let us make it real. Dennis.
In this quest for power, it amazes me, family means nothing. Antonio betrayed his brother, and now he's trying to get Sebastian to betray his brother. It just means nothing to people that want power.
Yeah, nothing but the power seems to matter, right? Nothing but how they get it and the payoff for it. There's wealth involved. There's the power over people, right? Like he says, his men were once my fellows. Now they are my men. I used to be equal, and now they obey me. I rule them. There's such beautiful seduction in Shakespeare's text. Go ahead, Lisa Barron.
I think also this passage points to the fickleness of a nation or a crowd and trendy leadership and who is popular at one moment isn't at the next. Sebastian in line 270 says, but for your conscience. And Antonio says, oh, conscience, it's like a boil on my heel. Yeah. You know? And he raises it again. Well, you know, what about the people? Mm. And there's this line, oh, you know, they're fickle, they'll change their opinions. I can't quite find it, but it reminds me of Caesar too, and how we see a nation, a crowd so easily swayed. Whoever's the most dynamic or charismatic, it reminds me of modern day politics, how Antonio just assumes that, oh, don't worry about convincing the people, you just have to want it and we'll work it out.
Yep. I'm going to find that part because I thought it was really described beautifully.
Yeah, about, I'm trying to find it too.
Yeah, I'm going to get right there. Something about they will lap the milk we tell.
Yes, that's what I meant to find, that passage, right?
Here it is. For all the rest, They'll take suggestion as a cat laps milk. They'll tell the clock to any business that we say befits the hour.
That's it.
Yep. And right at that moment, bam, Sebastian's doubts are answered. And right after that, he finishes that blank verse line, thy case, dear friend, shall be my precedent. As thou gots Milan, I'll come by Naples. Done. Everything's answered. Let's go. Yep. Beautiful. Go ahead, Rob.
I see a little bit of contrast with Julius Caesar, Mark Antonio, and the exercise of power in Tempest seems to be very personalized, that power is being exercised against particular people. In this case, Sebastian is going to kill Alonso. In Marcus Antonio, he's trying to raise a mob. He's trying to raise an army. Now, it's implied here that if he's successful, the people will follow, but it really is a different way of exercising power. I'm going to attain power if I can kill this guy. Mm. It's very, very personal. And I think throughout this play, there is this personal nature to the exercise of power that contrasts with some other discussions of power that we've seen elsewhere.
Really great, Rob, really great. Yeah, absolutely. And not only is it personal, it's family, right? It is family, which goes way back to the early stories of Cain and Abel and into that brotherly relationship there. Go ahead, Lisa.
Yeah, I just wanted to reply to Robert really quick. And in Caesar, it's the power of language and rhetoric that sways the crowd. And here it's a death that they're plotting, yes.
Yep, a violent act. Yeah, go ahead, Mila.
Well, you know, Shakespeare has Claudius himself call the fratricide the eldest primal curse, the action with the eldest primal curse upon it. So we know that he's aware of this notion that killing your brother is against all the mandates of decency, ethics, religion, everything. It's the eldest crime. And it has the primal curse upon it. So this is a really big step to take in Shakespeare's, but he flirts with it frequently, more than once.
Yeah. Other thoughts and responses. You can even look at it thematically, or you can again take a look at how Shakespeare has Antonio going about this seduction of Sebastian by just dropping. I love all the O's that Shakespeare gives Antonio to say, that are in there for him to just make it so delicious to be doing this is just really wonderful. And how you can take a look at how he just pulls him along. Oh, you would be so great. You would be so great. You have this chance to be great. Oh, man, if you could see what I see. And he doesn't even tell him what it is for quite a ways into that. He makes him want it before he even tells him what it is. Which what does that do for you? What does that make you think or remind you of or argue against? What's your thoughts in terms of that type of person?
Well, Machiavellian.
Indeed.
Richard III says he will put Machiavelli to school. Antonio is following in his footsteps.
Yeah.
Probably enough to convict him of incitement to murder.
Maybe. It's not on tape, though. Go ahead, Deborah.
When I saw this play, it was, to me, the most chilling moment was when Antonio is talking about his conscience and says, "Aye, sir. Where lies that?"
Yeah.
And it was just that cold, just really chilling And I thought, oh, my, I would never want to meet this guy.
Right, right. He's like a mafia don.
Yeah. You know,
it's absolutely, when a killing needs to be done, there is no room for conscience in it.
Can I say just a quick word about that? Because I think that's very important point. And I think it's very much a part of the way Shakespeare does what Stephen Greenblatt calls inventing, you know, the self, self-realization, finding the self, the notion that you can go internally for a set of values is the keystone to modern psychology. And Shakespeare really has a way of sort of tapping into that. When Antonio says, where lies that? I think he means literally and physiologically. Remember in King Lear, King Lear wants to anatomize Goneril, I think, to see what breeds around her heart. Where does this tendency to evil lie? Where is it in the physiology of the body? And Antonio says, well, I don't know. It might be in my foot. You know, I feel a little pain. I could put my slipper on, but it's nowhere near my heart. And conscience, of course, is a very big theme for Shakespeare. We won't, it's less to do with power, although it curbs the desire for power. But I don't think we need to go into it anymore. But I think that's very important. This notion that he's talking about an internal curb, something inside him that could prevent him from reaching for power, but it does not. Remember, conscience was a theme in Titus, in Aaron's description. You know, you have a thing called conscience, you stupid Christians, right? You keep the oaths you make. Yeah. So this idea of conscience as a guide is a very important moment there, I think.
Yeah, and speaking of Richard III, that comes out of that dream he has where he's like, wait a minute, do I have a conscience? Exactly. What is this? What is this that's happening to me right now? And oh my God, now that I'm starting to acknowledge it, I've become afraid. And it's a really incredible acknowledging of the power of a conscience. Go ahead.
Oh, and so Myla, I think that's so lovely to this idea of the physical embodiment of conscience. I think of Romeo when he goes to the friar and says, where in my foul anatomy, you know, and after he's been banished, and also Richard II looking in the mirror. So this inward looking at physicality and conscience. I love that. No, that sounds like a paper.
Excellent. Any other thoughts about this relationship and where it might have come from, where it's going, and what Shakespeare might be revealing?
Well, let me just go back to the idea that they don't repent. You know, and that makes them very different from Richard III. Richard III is far more vicious. He kills a lot of people, but he, and at the end, he is the tragic hero, and he finds his own humanity in his conscience, which takes him out of the inhumane world. And Antonio and Sebastian, I'm always struck by the fact that they just fall silent.
Yeah, the only thing that they mention after being forgiven is about drunkenness and can they make money off of Caliban? That's it. That's all they say after that. That's it.
That's good. I had forgotten that, but that's good. That's
marketable. And then, oh God, look at this guy. He said, hey, where did he get wine? That's it. You know, so yeah. Not much there, dialogue about whether or not they are even repentant or, okay, I'll accept this forgiveness, even though I didn't seem to ask for it. We'll go to Herb, and then Bob, is your hand up? As I say, we'll go to Herb, and then Bob. Go ahead, Herb.
Just a quick staging note. This moment, you know, a soliloquy, you know, usually a blank stage, someone, you know, stands in the center and speaks out. It just takes it to the next level to be able to have this kind of outward professing of thoughts and feelings while standing in and around the people they're plotting is just, it's amazing.
That's true. Yeah, that's a great point. I hadn't thought about that. That there they are, the bodies you're about to enact this deadly action upon are right there. Who, and even to the audience at that time, would right. look dead already.
Right.
And the same way Antonio brings that up and says, look at them. Look, they're sleeping, but they might as well be to look. And the audience is looking at them and saying, yeah. Yeah, there it's right there. That's a great point that to have that visual and that representation of those folks right there. That's great. Go ahead, Bob.
It's curious that they don't go through with it. They don't go through with it because Gonzalo wakes up. So maybe Gonzalo is the public shaming. And of course, Ariel is behind it all. Mm-hmm. And so maybe she is exercising an element of not consciousness, but it is curious after they get so excited about it, why they don't just go through with it.
I always did wonder what was the thought behind Sebastian going, oh, but one word, oh, you know, and obviously it's a sudden thought. To me, that's why Shakespeare puts the oh there. It's something sudden. It's gotten him. Who knows what it is? It's, you know, you try as the performer of it to justify it on a human level so that it does have some understanding rather than just a literary device to give Ariel a chance to step forward, speak his piece, sing his song, and wake everybody, get ready for everybody to wake up. So there's got to be something. And as that actor, you got to come up with something to justify it for yourself, even though it's never explained to the audience what that thought is. Yeah. Go ahead, Michael Clements.
Oops. Oh, yeah, I'm off. So Robert mentioned Ariel as a she. Jeff, you mentioned Ariel as a he. Totally off topic. What are your thoughts? Is Ariel a he or a she, or does it matter?
Well, the pronoun is he in the play.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. But that just could be because the actors all were. You know, but the pronoun for that character is he throughout the play.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yep. All right. Anything else about this passage? And we can step into the funny one. We'll take a breather from all this dark destruction and get to the funny one. All right, I'll remember to share my screen this time. Thank you for that reminder. All right, can you see it? Everybody see it? All right, so we want to take a look at Caliban, Trinculo, and Stephano. So let's get to 130. The interesting thing that I see about all this is that it's Caliban who establishes the status. It's Caliban in his discovery of these creatures, Stephano and Trinculo, who immediately recognizes something in them, even perhaps a god, and Caliban's the one that immediately establishes, here's the status. You are this and I am this in this relationship. And one of the things to point out, as I'm sure you're all well versed in now, is that the use of prose and blank verse that Shakespeare has. And watch how often as we go through and follow, it's not so much in this scene, you'll see it kick in at some point. But then as we go through these later passages with this trio, Caliban is speaking in blank verse, and Stephano and Trinculo are speaking in prose, which is an interesting dynamic that we could examine when we get there. So Caliban hears them talking, says, these be fine things, and if they be not sprites, that's a brave god and bears celestial liquor, I will kneel to him. So immediately establishes, you are more powerful than me, you are higher than me, and I will kneel to you. And then we move down to here. Caliban says, I'll swear upon that bottle to be thy true subject, for the liquor is not earthly. So again, giving him that position of some other beyond earth king and lord. Here, swear then how thou escapes will come through it. They're talking about the liquor, how he's got it stashed away, and they're starting to have a bit of a good time on this until he has Caliban asks, here, hast thou not dropped from heaven? Stephano, out of the moon, I do assure thee, I was the man in the moon when time was, and Caliban, believing it, I have seen thee in her, and I do adore thee. My mistress showed me thee, and thy dog, and thy bush. Come, swear to that, kiss the book. I will furnish it anon with new content, swear. So they're now going through a ritual of establishing this power structure. You have said what it is, now swear to it. And then Trinculo starts to talk to Stephano about him. Crazy monster, I'm afeard of him, very weak monster. And then he says, well, that was a pretty good drink there, monster. And now Caliban starts to describe to them the benefit that they will have in this relationship. I will show thee every fertile inch of the island, and I will kiss thy foot. I prithee, be my God. And again, reinforcing this, by this light, a most perfidious and drunken monster, when God's asleep, he'll rob his bottle. I'll kiss thy foot. I'll swear myself thy subject. Come on then down and swear. So we start to see Stephano start to embrace his new position in this world. As far as he knows, they're the only ones left on the island, right? He doesn't know that others have been saved. And Trinculo is, I'll laugh myself to death at this puppy-headed monster, most scurvy monster, can find in my heart to beat him. Stephano, come kiss, but the poor monster's in drink and abominable balls. Now, boom, this is where we see now Caliban shifts into the blank verse, which, as we know, often means, because obviously it's not a status thing here. We do know that Caliban learned to speak by someone of high status, but he was just speaking prose earlier. Something has changed here now. Often when that happens in this, it does indicate a heightened passion or purpose or intensity for the character who shifts from prose into poetry. So something is kicked in. Maybe it's the liquor that's got him all fired up. But here he goes, off and running now. I'll show thee the best springs. I'll pluck thee berries. I'll fish for thee and get thee wood enough. A plague upon the tyrant that I serve. I'll bear him no more sticks, but follow thee, thou wondrous man. Trinculo continuing to joke and mock him. Caliban stands up, still speaking in blank verse. I prithee, let me bring thee where crabs grow, and I with my long nails will dig thee pig nuts, show thee a jay's nest, and instruct thee how to snare the nimble marmoset. I'll bring thee to clustering filberts, and sometimes I'll get thee young scammels from the rocks. Wilt thou go with me? I prithee now, lead the way without any more talking. Trinculo, the king, and all our company else being drowned, we will inherit here. Here, bear my bottle. Fellow Trinculo will fill him by and by again, and off they go singing and dancing. So now this power structure is established, and it all came from Caliban. So before we, because we're getting near the time, let's jump to the next time we see these guys. In Act 3, Scene 2, because we spend in the play some time with Miranda and Ferdinand, and we'll come back to the pursuit of power people. Boop, boop, boop. Here. And we hear, now we can see it's fairly well established, right? Stephano's talking to Trinculo, tell not me, when the butt is out, we will drink water, not a drop before. Therefore, bear up and boredom. Servant monster, drink to me. Stephano's fully embraced it now, refers to Caliban right off the bat, servant monster. And Trinculo's like, servant monster, the folly of this island. They say there's but five, we are three of them. If the other two be brain like us, the state totters. So Trinculo's having a good old drunken time. Drink, servant monster, when I bid thee. Thy eyes are almost set in thy head. So we see again, since we last saw them, Stephano has really embraced this new power structure in which he is in charge. And again, we see Trinculo and Stephano speaking in the prose conversation. My man monster has drowned his tongue. Thou shalt be my lieutenant monster or my standard. So he's putting military positions in place. And Trinculo again, joking, your lieutenant, if you list, he's no standard and will not run. Off they are. They're still playing. But we see Stephano tells him to speak. Caliban says, how does thy honor? Let me lick thy shoe. I'll not serve him. He is not valiant. So here we have Caliban speaking in the prose, joining in this kind of drunken conversation for a while. Lo, how he mocks me. Wilt thou let him, my lord? Again, turning for protection from the higher status person. What's expected of that? Lord, quoth he, that a monster should be such a natural. And we know that that refers to that kind of natural fool, that natural entertainment of one who is handicapped in some way, who's diminished in mental capacity. So it's their weaknesses that are entertaining, not their wit or song and speech capability. Lolo again, bite him to death, I prithee. I thank my noble lord. Would thou be pleased to hearken once again to the suit I made to thee? Marry, will I kneel and repeat it. I will stand and so shall Trinculo. And here comes, it's still about the funny. Ariel jumps in, starts playing with them. Caliban is fighting back and forth. I would my valiant master would destroy thee. I don't lie. All that arguing, and then boom, we see it again. Stephano says, proceed. It kicks into the verse. I say by sorcery he got this isle. From me he got it. If thy greatness will, revenge it on him, for I know thou darest. But this thing dare not, pointing to Trinculo. That's most certain. Thou shalt be lord of it, and I'll serve thee. Very different energy behind this power structure than what we saw before. Somebody convincing somebody to do something deadly so that he can be power, and then somebody convincing somebody to just take it, I give it to you. How shall this be compassed? Canst thou bring me to the party? Yea, my lord, I'll yield him thee asleep where thou mayest knock a nail into his head. Ariel again, Caliban still in the poetry, but a pied ninny's this, thou scurvy patch. I do beseech thy greatness, capitalize, give him blows, and take his bottle from him. When that's gone, he shall drink naught but brine, for I'll not show him where the quick freshes are. Stephano and Trinculo go back and forth. Caliban's laughing about it. And again, still in poetry, beat him enough. After a little time, I'll beat him too. And off they go until Caliban now tells the plan. Now compare this to what we heard between Antonio and Sebastian earlier. Why, as I told thee, 'tis a custom with him in the afternoon to sleep. There thou mayst brain him, having first seized his books, or with a log, batter his skull, or punch him with a stake, or cut his weasand with thy knife. Remember, first to possess his books, for without them, he's but a sot, as I am, nor hath not one spirit to command. They all do hate him as rootedly as I. Burn but his books. He hath brave utensils, for so he calls them, which when he has a house, he'll deck with all. And that most deeply to consider is the beauty of his daughter. He himself calls her a nonpareil. I never saw a woman, but only Sycorax, my dam, and she. But she as far surpasseth as Sycorax, as grace does the least. And then we will destroy him while he's sleeping, and we'll just end the scene there. I want to take a look at the parallels that are in this part and turn that part over to you guys as I open things back up so I can see you. So, a lot of parallels here. What did you recognize, and what could that be giving you insight to there? Dennis, And then Bob.
I thought it was interesting that Caliban actually knew how to defeat Prospero, is take away his books and learning. Mm-hmm. Is how you can defeat him. And the other thing is, I don't know if Shakespeare intended him to be a deformed monster. In Julie Taymor's movie, he's a large man, very strong. And he's pledging fealty, but why? He would rather have these guys, Stephano, rather than, he hates Prospero, so he'd rather have this master. But why does he need a master? Why can't he just be on his own? So he's so trained to be obeisant and inferior to someone. That's all he can think about.
Yeah.
It's kind of sad.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent. Go ahead, Bob, and then Miller.
I was going to make a couple of points. First, I am troubled by his depiction of a indigenous person. On the negative side, Caliban wants Miranda, and he drinks. So this is, I wonder if this is the origin of this attitude toward indigenous people. But separate from that, it seems to me Caliban has a very calculated strategy to gain power. He needs power to free himself from Prospero. Mm-hmm. And Prospero, through his magic, can control Caliban and sick Caliban and sick evil spirits on him, so he cannot get away. And one could imagine that this entire scene with Trinculo and Stephano is that Caliban is his strategy to kill Prospero. And the one piece of evidence of this is when they have when they dress up in the costumes and run around, mm-hmm. Caliban is saying, no, let's go kill Prospero first. You guys are off track so here.
Yeah, put that stuff down.
So he does. I think he was seeking power, and he humbles himself in a sense in order to be able to convince them, the two of them, to go kill Prospero.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting that you would think of Caliban as an indigenous person, in that, yes, he was born on the island, but his mother was not of the island. She was a witch who was sent there, much like Prospero was. We don't know who she was pregnant by when she arrived there, right? He's not quite a natural outgrowth of that island. He was born there, but was kind of brought there in utero before being brought there, but does represent a native of that land, in that he understands the nature of that place so intuitively and is so connected to the nature of that island. So there is something that's there. Mike, we'll get to you. We'll go to Lisa, Mila. I'm sorry, Mila, Lisa, then Michael.
No, let Lisa go first.
Okay, go ahead, Lisa.
It's interesting. I think it's by no accident that we have Caliban, who's supposed to be a savage and deformed slave, and Trinculo, a jester, Stephano, a drunken butler, all characters that have been suppressed in terms of power. Yet when they play out this power fantasy, you would expect maybe they'd be more empathetic to suppress people that haven't been in power, but they aren't kind to each other. Right. So is Shakespeare making a comment about, is it human nature to stratify in terms of power?
Mm.
Are all rulers fair or ethical?
Mm. Yeah, great question, right? We see that happening there. Go ahead, Mila.
Well, I was just going to go to the clothing thing, the scene that you mentioned, Jeff, when they get distracted by the fancy clothes. I mean, Prospero hangs his robes out to distract them, and it works. And Caliban is smarter than both Stephano and Trinculo. There's no question about that. And he only drinks, of course, because they give him liquor, which doubly reinforces the colonial parallel, right? Because they bring the liquor to him. He never saw it before. He calls it a celestial drink. But you remember that Antonio said that his garments fit nicely upon him. Mm-hmm. And now Stephano and Trinculo are really deluded by the garments. They want the robes, and Caliban is saying, no, 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 no. Kill the man first, right? Bash his brains out. So he's a lot smarter than they are. Mm-hmm. That I think is a very important thing. But it's also undeniable, as much as I love this play, I also have a lot of friends in the Caribbean and I do a lot of work there, that he is created as a kind of natural servant. You talked about him as turning from one master to another. He wants power, but he wants someone else to give it to him. Mm-hmm. And he ends the play kneeling to be obedient hereafter and apologizing for having mistaken a drunkard for a god, right? And he kneels to Prospero. Yeah. So there is that, since he is not an indigenous person, I think there's no question. When Shakespeare, if he's anything, he's usually identified with the Africans, because he kind of, his mother kind of comes from Algeria or someplace like that. So he's more often, and in Cesare's play, he's just billed as a black slave. That's his identifier. So that I think it's much more, you say he's brought into the island, it's much more the colonial enterprise in which the enslaved were brought into the island along with everyone else, that shadows beneath the surface of this play that the Caribbean people have picked up on so much.
Right, right. And to do work, right? Even at that end, when he's kneeling, he's told, you go clean up where I live and then you'll be forgiven, but go clean it first.
But he does make the point that he owned the island before Prospero got there. Yeah. So that's where the indigenous argument could have a little bit of merit. Yeah. You know, it was mine and I showed you everything, right?
Yep, that's right. He was there first. Rich or Linda, whoever wants to speak. Oh, sorry, let's go to Michael. I promised Michael first, then we'll go up to the, we'll go out to Arizona. Go ahead, Michael.
Yeah, just to mention, yeah, in my little synopsis, Caliban is referred to as the spawn of the devil and a witch. He is also referred to as being not honored with human shape. And I can't remember exactly where that is. And of course, we all know the you know, the anagram, you know, Caliban, cannibal. So we never see him doing cannibalism. But of course, there's that subtext.
Yeah, and he talks about eating berries and clams and other things along those lines. Yeah, and again, I think it's Prospero who calls him the child of the witch and the devil, and I don't know how Prospero would know that, you know, because Sycorax was dead before Prospero arrived on that island. She's the one who pinned Ariel into the tree. And she was dead and gone, which left Ariel stuck in that tree for all those years until Prospero came and freed him. All right, Richard, Linda, and then Mila.
I just had a question. Is there some thought that he is based on a lot of the explorers' books that came back with stories and drawings of fantastic animals and semi-humans that had their heads in their chests and stories like that?
That could very well be. There's definitely been writings that came even pre-Othello. When you look at what the perspective, everybody's got their drawings and images. And when you hear Othello's descriptions of his travels, the creatures and various shapes of creatures and various peoples that he's met in his travels, describing there. And then there's this great this book that was out that was exploring Shakespeare's use of language almost directly from a travel pamphlet. There was a writer, and I'm forgetting the details of it. I don't know if you would know, Mila, but there's a book that explores this parallel of a ship that on its way to the Virginia colony to work was in a storm and was shipwrecked on Bermuda. And then they had to stay there for almost a year or so, rebuild the boat, and then continue on. And some of the people who were shipwrecked on Bermuda were trying to stay there and get out of their contract that they had signed with the Virginia company. so that they could stay on Bermuda because everything there was plentiful and beautiful and temperate. And but the captain of the ship who survived the wreck said, no, your contract is still binding. You must. And they had debates about it and political votes about it on the island. But yeah. Part of that group was a writer who was intending to write a travelogue, basically, and came back with a pamphlet describing these adventures. They did eventually rebuild the boat, go on to Virginia, in which so many of them got sick and lived a horrible life. And I know they were so, had to be so pissed that they left Bermuda, for anybody who's been there. And then eventually this writer took one of the ships back to London because he wasn't contracted to the Virginia Company. He had paid his way to try to write this travel book. He got back with it. He wrote a pamphlet about it, couldn't get anybody to publish it. But that pamphlet, he wrote a letter to somebody that had some of the text in it. And the descriptions that he used to describe Bermuda are nearly word for word the description that Gonzalo uses to describe the island.
Yes.
So there's some thought that Shakespeare came across this letter somehow that this guy was using to try to find sponsors for the publication of his book. So yeah Rich, you landed on this idea of the exotic, whose imagery or ideas and thoughts of these exotic lands being brought back to London. It's well known that many natives of these lands that people travel to were brought back as gifts of their sponsors or ways to get in to access the nobility. Say, look what I brought back. Look at this nearly human creature, because they certainly separated themselves from many of the natives they encountered. So you're onto something there, Rich, for sure.
Jeff, can I jump in really quick? I want to give you a note, because I'm looking in a book and there was actually news of that story, the hurricane and the shipwreck in Bermuda. And it was a William Strachey.
That's the guy.
Yep. And the story was called The True Repertory of the Wreck, and it was circulating in London in 1610. Yep. Virginia yep. Company, yes. I just wanted to support you on that.
Yeah, William Strachey was the writer who was intending to write a book about it. Yeah, great. Thank you, Lisa. Go ahead, Mila.
Yeah. Thank you, Lisa. I was going to make that point, too. There is a book about Strachey, the one I think you're talking about, Jeff, called A Brave Vessel. The True Castaways Who Rescued Jamestown by Hobson Woodward. So, all that's playing in there. And there was the description of the storm, which people always link to the Tempest anyway. But the direct source for the name Caliban and for Gonzalo's description of the sovereignty of the island is Montaigne's essay on cannibals. And so I think that it is primarily assumed that Caliban is an anagram of cannibal, obviously, but Montaigne attacking Europe is setting up the noble savage. I mean, his cannibals are like 8 feet tall. They only eat each other for heroic reasons. They have a kind of nobility and honor that the Europeans lack. And Montaigne is really attacking the European court, the French court in particular, for its cannibalizing of each other metaphorically. Mm. And he's setting up the cannibals as the alternative. And I think many people think that Shakespeare is saying no to Montaigne. Caliban is not a tall, handsome, heroic warrior. He is instead this kind of fish monster. Now, at the same time, he's one of the most interesting characters in the play. He does have this feel for the island, and Shakespeare always has a way of getting inside the outsider to give you some sense of who that outsider is and what he's really feeling. And I think that Caliban garners a fair amount of sympathy, but it's Montaigne that I think we also need to look to directly, because Gonzalo's little passage when he talks about no sovereignty, he directly quotes Montaigne. I mean, line for line. It's not just an almost parallel. It is exactly that passage directly from Montaigne. So it's very clear he knew the essay.
Very cool. Thank you, Mila. That's great. So, to go back to that passage and the parallels that I was hoping that you caught in that is we're very simple. I mean, you guys are too smart to stick with the simple. You go these great places. But simply put, we watched Sebastian and Antonio plot this while people were sleeping around him, and Caliban says, take him while he's sleeping. So there's something that must be in that vulnerability. In terms of taking somebody while they're asleep, that's the time to act. That's the time to take them. There's some vulnerability opening there that must be happening there. There's also a daughter involved in both of these plots. And in the first one, it's forget the daughter. Forget her. She's gone. She'll never hear anything from Milan until it's too late, until newborn babies have stumbled on their tendons. Forget her. She's gone. We will usurp her power too, but simply by forgetting about her. In this one, it's take the daughter, and she will bring thee forth brave brood. So there's these similar ideas in terms of power and where these women who are the inheritors of the position, they're supposed to be. I mean, Sebastian and Antonio make that point. Who's the heir? If Alonso should die, we acknowledge Ferdinand's dead. If Alonso's dead, who's next in line? Well, it's Claribel. Well, forget her. Forget her. And then here, the same thing. Well, if indeed this is that monarchical structure and Prospero does die, well, who's next in line? Well, it's Miranda. Well, no. You're next in line, and you take her as part of this reward. But they're both in there. They're both in these plots and very well, very much acknowledged in there. Go ahead, Dennis.
Yeah, just to follow up in your comment, when these people are sleeping and the plotters hesitate and they don't take the opportunity, they talk, but they don't do it. You were commenting on that. Mm-hmm. It's not an exact parallel, but it reminds me of Hamlet, where he had the chance to kill his father when his father was praying.
Yeah, his uncle.
His uncle. Okay, yeah. That's right. His father was already dead. So, to me, it says they have a shred of conscience, perhaps, or some decency in them that they don't do what they said they were going to do when they had the chance.
That could be. Yeah, the drunkards never get there. They're distracted by their drunkenness and by clothing, and then they're set upon by demon dogs and sent through the swamps. So they never quite get to the point where they could. They're standing over their target.
But perhaps they didn't really want to. They weren't that motivated to do it.
It could, yeah, absolutely. But Shakespeare doesn't put them at the precipice. Mm-hmm. So the danger isn't in there, which keeps it comedic. It keeps it lighthearted. Because we never get to that precipice of danger. Whereas he puts Sebastian and Antonio, they start this there. They start on the edge. And all they have to do is step. And then they don't at that moment that we've discussed before.
Deborah has her hand up.
Go ahead, Deborah.
Yeah, I was struck by when Prospero says, we are such stuff as dreams are made on, bringing back that whole theme through the whole play of sleep, dreaming, vulnerabilities, and just kind of reminding everyone that, you know, of that vulnerability inherent in being a human, I guess.
Yeah, that's right. Really, yeah, really good. Yep. And then he says our little lives are rounded with a sleep. So again, that parallel, that connection of death and sleep, you know, and again, somebody brought up Measure for Measure earlier too. And that's that parallel, that connection between sleep and death is in there too. Yeah, cool. Well, we're just about out of time, which is fine because we kind of tapped into later. I mean, the rest of Sebastian and Antonio's plot is really when we see them again later. And Antonio says to Sebastian, hey, we have not forgotten this plot. We're still going to do this. You remember. And then they never get another chance to do it. And then we already talked about what happens to Stephano and Trinculo and Caliban as they get comedically foiled in their plot to execute their violent usurpation of power. So again, we have these very interesting parallels going on in which they're both attempting to do the same thing for different reasons and different methodologies, very different point of views on it. One's dark and dangerous, and the other is comedic and silly and fumbling and all. But the structures for the examination are in both. And then to expand that idea of power, it's wrapped around with the other ones that we talked about. Caliban's place on that island, Prospero's power plays over Caliban and Ariel. Ariel constantly trying to work for freedom, always being promised and having it yanked a little bit further down the road, a little bit further down the road, one more task. So there's a lot of exploration of power in this play that Shakespeare obviously felt strongly he had to say something about it, because it's ripe through all of this. We have some things popping up in the chat, things about the pets. Yeah, there's that. We are such stuff as dreams are made of, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. Michael, I agree. The Tempest has some of Shakespeare's most memorable lines. Lou, super, thank you. Dennis, thanks everyone. Really fascinating discussion. Thanks, another great session. Yeah, I want to thank everyone. Oh, wait, was that one, Herb? Yes, next month. Yes, thank you. We're going to talk about the conspirators from Julius Caesar. I know that was brought, Lisa brought up Caesar earlier, and Mila commented on that. Lisa asking about Gonzalo being a moral compass.
Yeah, in Act 3, Scene 3, where he says, the creatures, though they're of monstrous shape, their manners are more gentle kind than of our human generation. So is he, you know, empathetic around power or difference? That's another day.
From the very start, our first introduction, well, not our first introduction is obviously in the storm, yeah. But our first introduction and understanding who he is, yeah, is Prospero's description of him and how he took care of him and the best he could within, yeah, power structure. There was only so much he could, yeah, do. Yeah, so again, April 5th, a month from now, the first Monday of April, we'll be doing Caesar and looking at that conspirators and how they go about their business toward power. Again, thank you everybody for really terrific, insightful, intelligent, wonderful conversation this evening. I love this. You guys are terrific. I appreciate it very much. So everybody, please stay well. I hope you're all willing to go get vaccinated so
yes,
live, yeah, again and go to the theater again and join in, yeah, person. So please stay healthy, take care of each other, take care of your loved ones, and live well. We'll see you all in a few weeks. Thank you very much for coming.
Bye. Thank you.
Good night, everybody.
Bye. Thank you.
Cheers, Jeff. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Everybody. Thanks, Jeff.
I want to thank
everybody.
Bye, everybody.